I wrote something, so I'm just going to actually read it. So here we go. If you are afraid of the future for whatever reason, then I advise you to get your own house in order and figure out a more effective way to communicate with others, whether they be friends, enemies, animals, vegetables, or minerals. So if you are scared that Trump is going to blow up the world, or if you are scared that you or your friends are going to be deported, or if you are scared that you will never find love and happiness, or if you are scared that you will never have enough money to enjoy the life that you would like to have, or if you are scared because you are always fighting with your partner and you fear never having a sustainable relationship, or if you are scared because your health is poor, then the first thing you should do is figure out how to love ye one another. You need to figure out how to treat others as you wish to be treated. You need to figure out how to stop calling names and ridiculing people and being sarcastic and shaming people and gossiping about people and spreading rumors and spreading lies and spreading misinformation and disinformation. You need to be vigilant over your thoughts and perceptions. You need to be aware of how your biases affect what you perceive and can distort what's really going on, which then can create more confusion, misunderstandings, abuse, etc. If you want your life to get better physically, emotionally, materially, and spiritually, and if you want our world to truly heal, it starts with you. It starts with each of us embracing compassion, empathy, consideration, honesty, integrity, generosity, acceptance, and forgiveness. Too many of us are too busy being self-righteous and egotistical, pointing the finger at others and doing nothing productive to truly heal the great divisions we have in our society. Be the solution, not the problem. Okay, so let me elaborate a little on that, because it may seem counterintuitive when I suggest that if you're afraid Trump's going to do horrible things, that you should get your own house in order and somehow that's going to have an effect on him. You need to really understand that, first of all minds are connected. If you want to believe that or not, it doesn't really matter, but all minds are connected at a subconscious level. And every thought you have adds to the collective unconscious in a good way or a bad way. Okay, so if you are constantly negative, angry, sarcastic, resentful, bitter, hostile, attacking, unloving, even if you feel justified that other people deserve it, you're part of the problem. You're adding negative fuel to the collective fire. Okay, you're not helping anything. Many of us get on Twitter and Facebook, etc., and when we see something we don't like, we just blast the crap out of the person, and we get our friends to blast the crap out of the person, and we call names, and we shame, and we do all sorts of stuff. And this is our way. I guess this is our way to affect change, and to some degree. It does. I'm not going to argue with that. Obviously, more people complain about certain things, but it's the way that it's done. To a large degree, it's the way that people resist. It's the way that people complain. It's the way that people, deal with other people. That is a big part of the problem. You know, you can disagree with someone without having to call names, shame, eviscerate, humiliate, etc. And whether you want to believe it or not, the uglier you are in your transactions with others, you know, you're just attacking yourself. You're just actually beating yourself up. You're actually sending a message to your subconscious mind that you're not really a nice person. You don't really deserve happiness and success and love. And your subconscious mind is going to do whatever it can to punish you and not reward you. You may think this is magical thinking, but it's not. What we think is what we get. And while I'm talking about what we think, I also want to point out to you that what we perceive is based upon what we think. You know, we think that we perceive things and then think about them. But no, it's actually we think about them and then we perceive them. So, for example, our biases. I've talked about this before. We have biases. When somebody says something that goes along with our bias, we're going to jump on the bandwagon, whether it's true or not. If someone says something that goes against our biases and belief systems, we're going to attack the crap out of them, whether they're actually right or wrong. Point being that our biases, our beliefs are not always right. We're not always right. We're not always correct. We're not always perceiving the situation properly. Oftentimes, we allow our biases to color our perceptions, and we don't give the other side, whatever it is, Republican or Democrat, left or right, we don't give the benefit of the doubt. We assume the worst. We assume that they're horrible people, that their intent is evil, rather than trying to look at the situation for what it is. And oftentimes, if you try to do that, if you try to recognize, okay, I have bias, and I don't want the bias to get in the way of my objectively evaluating a situation, then you've got to stop and think and not have some knee-jerk reaction to something somebody posts or something somebody says or something you see on TV. You need to stop and think. Critical thinking. Critical thinking doesn't mean criticizing other people. Critical thinking means, be objective. Look at the data. Analyze the data. Don't assume anything anybody is telling you is the truth or accurate. They could be misled. They could be confused. They could have severe biases. They could have a severe agenda that has nothing to do with you. And you're jumping on the bandwagon because they're making you think that it has to do with you, but it doesn't. So each of us has a responsibility to ourselves and to the world. If we want to make the world a better place, get your own house in order. Try to be the most consistent person you can be in terms of being ethical and honest and fair and just and reasonable and be willing to debate civilly and be willing to listen to the other side and be willing to consider the possibility that somebody who you hate might actually be right once in a while or somebody that you love might actually be wrong once in a while. So to embrace everything somebody you like says all the time without any critical thinking, without any kind of objectivity is a mistake. To hate somebody and jump on the hate wagon, no matter what that person says, without looking at the data, without actually looking at what the person said, not what other people told you that the person said, this is all very important. This is why our world is a mess. It's because each of us has given up our responsibility in terms of being an adult, in being an honest, fair-minded, objective adult. We need to think before we speak. We need to think before we act. We are all responsible for each other. We are all connected, and we're not going to get anywhere as long as we continue to attack each other. Even when we disagree, we don't have to attack. We can disagree civilly. It could make a world of difference. Let's take Trump, for example. Every time you hate what he's doing, you fear what he's doing, you think he's an imbecile, you think he's a moron, you think he's a sexist, racist, homophobe, xenophobe, whatever you think he is. And he may be, but the point is, every time you call him a name, every time you jump on the bandwagon of attacking him, it's not going to get you what you want. It's not going to enlighten him. It's not going to get him to change. It's not going to get him to reconsider his position and think because there are a lot of people screaming at him and calling him names that therefore he'll think twice about it and gain some incredible insight. It's going to fix him further. It's going to keep him more fixated on his position. It's going to make him more dogmatic, more stubborn. It's not helping. It's not helping. It's not just Trump. It's when we do this to anybody. If you want something from somebody, it's a lot better to not attack them and eviscerate them, okay? It just doesn't put them in a friendly mood to want to move in your direction to try to accommodate you. It's not going to happen. Now, it may not happen when you try to be civil and logical and reasonable. That may not happen either, but you have a better chance of it happening if you're not toxic and ugly in your transactions with others, no matter how justified you feel. No matter how afraid you may be, okay? It's just not smart. In the long run, it's not smart. In the short run, it feels great when we can get up there and say, he's a piece of crap, and he's this, and he's that, or Hillary, she's this, or she's a piece of crap, or she's corrupt, or it feels great. The ego loves it. the ego like revels in our, you know, the power that we feel being able to like trash somebody. It feels great. Yeah, but it's not great. And it's ego. And it's not, you know, it's not great. It doesn't get us anywhere. It only makes the divide even worse. And it doesn't help you. Every time we attack other people, even if we feel justified, we are diminishing ourselves. Okay? Because when we attack others, it's still an attack. And on an unconscious level, we don't admire ourselves for being ugly and nasty to others, even if we feel they deserve it. The message we send to our subconscious mind is that we're an angry, unkind person, and our subconscious mind, to some degree, is going to say, "Well, this person doesn't deserve success. He or she deserves failure," and so it affects your self-esteem on unconscious levels. You're not aware of it. But every time you trash somebody, on some level, you diminish yourself.